Okay. Hey there, folks. Thanks for tuning in to the SpinSheet Happy Hour on this Monday for our Summer Laundry Night series. We're watching a little video called Race Committee is Fun. It certainly is, especially the music. That's going to be our topic tonight is your questions are going to go to our special guests. I'm going to talk about Race Committee and... hold on one second. I'm losing control already. There we go. So thanks for tuning in. I'm Chris Charbonneau. This week we are talking about Race Committee, and we're going to take your questions, all the things that you've wanted to ask, but or all the answers that you want, but we're afraid to ask, or something like that. Before we get started, I wanted to, of course, thank our sponsor, Mount Gay Rum. They continue to support quality programming like this that we bring you once or twice every month. Very good. Well, with that, I'm going to bring on our editor extraordinaire, Miss Molly Winans. Hi, Molly.
You almost called me Wally, didn't you?
Yes, I almost called you Wally. Sorry.
Well, anyway, happy Monday. Feels a little weird to say the happy hour on Monday, but you know, here we are. It's been cheesy.
Here we are.
It looks like you're drinking in the office again.
But the office is now fully stocked.
Yeah,
we've gotten back into the swing of things, and you know, we've got a nice supply of ginger beer, and we always have a great supply of Mount Gay rum. So
yeah, well, I did hear that there was an emergency in the office recently where there was nothing to mix it with, and it was quite a scary thing. But ginger beer has arrived, and.
Yes.
Although I'm not in the office, and I'm actually just having a little mocktail tonight because I'm going paddling. My little bands in the sand mug here, but so anyway.
You're not drinking paddle or paddle and drink.
Yeah. But I'll be sure to have a Mount Gay rum when I'm done paddling. How's that?
Very good.
So anyway, awesome. Cheers. Yeah. I'm excited for tonight.
I am too.
We have a couple of very experienced race committee members here, and they just happen to be married to each other. And I imagine we're going to have a variety of people on the show tonight, people who know Taryn Teague and Bruce Bingman and know some of the great work that they do on race committees all over the place, not just in Annapolis. They're they were in Key West. They've been in Charleston. They've been in Block Island. We'll let you tell them all about it. But if you have any questions to ask them, go ahead and pop your questions in the comments. Also, let us know where you're chiming in from. It's really great to hear when people from outside the Chesapeake are joining us. And, you know, if you're not a racer and you have questions, feel free to pop them up. And if you are a racer and you have questions, that's good too. So, awesome. I mean, we should bring our guests on and see what they have to say.
Boom. Hi.
Hi, Taryn and Bruce. Welcome to the SpinSheet Happy Hour.
Hi, Molly and Char. Good to be here.
We've redubbed this SpinSheet Summer Laundry Night for summer because people have a lot of things to do on Friday nights. So we thought, well, Monday it is. There's little racing on Monday, but there isn't a whole lot of racing on Monday. So welcome. And we're really glad to have you here. And Sharba, you're going to go into the green room and into the control room there?
The control room. I'll meet you in the green room later.
In the SpinSheet world headquarters?
Yep. I'm going to disappear and we'll return at the end.
All right, great. Okay. See you later. So Taryn and Bruce, we always ask people the same question when they first come on the program. And why not start at the beginning? You know, how you got into sailing? I know you guys both have long sailing backgrounds and you don't have to go into great detail about it, but how you got into sailing, how you got into racing, and then how that turned into race committee work. Because I know you guys are active racers as well as committed volunteers. So why don't we start with you, Taryn?
Sure. So I come from a boating family. We grew up boating and swimming and everything else running around down in North Carolina, and went to Camp Seafair and Seagull. And then from there, just really knew I loved sailing and motorboating, anything on the water, and then began racing, came up here, and I met a cute crew that said he could come sailing with me every once in a while. And from there on, I ended up buying a boat before a car, and it was just a priority. So it's been great fun. It's a family sport, and got into race management because I wanted to see the sport improve a little bit. I think race management's really come a long way in the last 20 years or so. So, and it was great fun, and I've enjoyed it. We've both enjoyed it. So, and here we are. Go, Bruce.
How's you, Bruce?
All right. Well, I'm a Southern California kid, and my parents tried to figure out what to do with me and decided they'd get rid of me pretty good if they sent me to sailing camps and things like that. So I learned how to sail on a Sabbat and then worked up from there. I did sail in college on a Shields, of all things. I hate to admit that because now that dates me a little bit. But
yeah, well, hey, they're beautiful boats. Let's stick to the beauty of the boat.
And then the Navy snatched me for a few years, and it's tough to sail when you're underwater. But I did some underwater work for them. And then very fortunately, they sent me back to grad school. And then I got snatched by the guys here at headquarters and got stationed in Washington, D.C., although I spent a lot of time away, but that was still my home port. So I started sailing here with Dick Lamb in Snipes. And then, of course, made a great error of buying a boat. and then I had to get crew. And I even made a bigger error. I got a bigger boat, which I needed more crew. And I was short crew one day. And they said, oh, we know this girl who knows something about sailing. And, you know, it was all downhill from there.
So,
so she actually crewed for me first, but then she bought the boat and I ended up crewing for her, and I sold my boat. I don't know how that works out, but then I got snagged into race management actually on the very first Annapolis to Bermuda race that was actually run out of the old Severn River Yacht Club at Mears Marina before Eastport took it over. And I got snagged into that, and I found that pretty fascinating. Although I regretted not having raced on the race because I was pretty much into offshore racing if I could get the time. But it whetted my interest. And then Taryn really didn't go into it, but we really got drawn in by the 96 Olympics, where U.S. Sailing came and took a bunch of us from the Chesapeake that had some race committee experience. And, you know, we all got up on the next step, so to say, from there. And then from then on, we pretty much split our time between racing and race committee. So
I just had a question, and you guys have owned a succession of boats. Just out of curiosity, what kind of boats have they been and what kind of boat do you have now?
Well, they started out as a Morsey boat, of all things, for anybody who remembers the old Morsey rule. And then we got it. Then I had an IOR 3/4 tonner for a while. Then I met Taryn, and she thought that was way too big. So we raced her boat for a while, which was an Albacore.
So I had an Albacore. So that's a boat they sail out of Washington. They still do.
Yeah, sure.
It's great international class, and they sail down in West River a little bit.
They still do?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So from there, we went on, and our next joint boats were a J27 and then a... Viper, the 28-foot Viper.
Well, and we got
a blockade runner, which was a
B32.
Mm-hmm. And then finally the FAR 30, which has been a great boat for many reasons. You can pull everything, and it's great competition level, and a lot of families do it as well. So fun boats. And today, about 6 years ago, we bought a powerboat to help us with race committee. So that's a East Bay 38 a signal boat.
Well, you know, because of Prop Talk, we have noticed over the years that lots of sailors own power boats, but you can't necessarily say the same thing about lots of power boaters. So most sailors are power boaters at some point or another, if not, you know, by nautical, you know, as they say. So so for anyone who might be new to racing, can you summarize just... If you could just summarize what a race committee does, you know, why they're there and what they do.
So I'll take that one.
Go.
Because as a race officer, I've been trying to tell people, a lot of people ask me, well, what do you do? And I make the analogy with football. When you go to a football game, the football grid is already there. You know, the stadium's there, everything's there. And then they go out and play football. But when you go out on the water to race a sailboat race, none of that is there for you. You have to look up the weather and the location and the wind and the angles. And there's just a lot to it, to where you put your race course and how you put it, the decisions you make as a race manager to make a good, fair, fun race for the people that are going to be there that day.
Yeah, let me jump in here. What we're really saying is that we set the playing field. So it's up to us to figure out where the start line is and then where the weather mark is going to be and all of that sort of thing. And then you've got to go figure out not only where it's going to be, but how long it's going to be, because you actually typically you have some goal in mind. You want your race to last an hour. You want it to last 2 hours or whatever. Or if it's a point-to-point race, you might have the option, depending on how you set the sailing instructions, to set a weather mark to start it off with. So everybody gets to go to windward before they turn the corner and then go on their distance race. Or it might just be a straight distance race. But however you do it, you're setting up the field. And it gets a little tricky, by the way, for what we call an off-wind start, a distance race where you're not going to weather. Now you've got maybe a spinnaker start or whatever, and it gets a little tricky to set the starting line up so you don't get everybody jammed at one end and that sort of thing. But there's some rules of thumb and guidelines, and U.S. Sailing offers some coursework, and you can take some courses in how to set a race course, and you can actually get some certifications. And Taryn, I'm sure we'll talk about that.
Yeah, that's one of our questions coming up. But I want to ask, and I know this varies widely depending on how big the race is and how big the boats are, but what are some of the main jobs on a race committee that people perform?
Well, let's start with the signal boat. The signal boat, you will have the primary principal race officer, and you'll have a person, the deputy race officer, to help them. But then everybody wears a couple of hats, does a couple of jobs. So you need a person to do the timing, to get your sequence starting at the right time. So you need a timer, and then you'll need someone to do flags for the signals. You'll need someone to drive the boat, a boat driver, and perhaps owner, and that knows how to anchor and navigate. And you'll need somebody to call the starting line and set up the race course. So there's a lot of separate duties that you can do, and some of them are overlapping.
Mm-hmm. And do people on the race committee have specialties, or are there some job swapping that happens?
Well, a lot of people have specialties based on, you know, what their interests are, and some racing gets a little complicated, so you have to be at the top of the game in your specialty sometimes. For example, the timers, they not only have to be able to time and know the script and the classes, they would need to know how to use the radio and communicate, you know, with the class and really be the heartbeat of the race committee. But we try to a lot of times team up people to have a junior person and a more senior person, so you can really mentor people coming through and share the knowledge as you go through.
Yeah. Now Taryn has left off one part here. She went through the signal boat. There's another part of the race committee, which is a fairly important part, and that is the mark boats that are out there. They're the people that are going to inflate the marks and drop them, or if you happen to be using mark bots, which we've had some recent experiences with, they still have to be out there to guide them in place and kind of shepherd them just to make sure that all goes well. And mark boat becomes kind of a specialty in itself. You become a pretty astute wind reader and gauge of what's happening on the course, because frequently a PRO, the principal race officer, will be calling the mark boat and asking the mark boat operator at the weather mark what they're seeing up there and if the course change is required and that sort of thing. So there's that end of it as well. And typically on a mark boat, you'll have a mark boat operator, somebody who's actually driving the boat, which is a skill in itself. You'll have a mark boat officer that's sort of taking the wind readings and kind of running it and deciding in conjunction with the PRO where you're going to set the mark. And then you'll have a helper or two to help set the marks. And of course, most importantly, at the end of the day, retrieve the marks, which can be fairly easy. In the Chesapeake, it's normally pretty easy. Off Hawaii, where it's 2,500 feet deep, it's a little more difficult.
Yeah. So for anyone who's just tuning in, we are talking to Taryn Teague and Bruce Bingman, very experienced race committee members, just about what they do on race committee. If you have any questions for them, even if it feels like we're not on the topic, go ahead and pop them into the comments and we will get to them when we get to them, or we'll pop them up right away. So feel free to ask race committee anything you've always wanted to ask race committee, because you have the ear of two people who know a lot about it. So I wanted to ask you, and you guys might have different answers to this question, but let's talk about some of the challenges that race committees face. Because every once in a while, I do hear people complaining a little bit about the race committee as if they're just twiddling their thumbs up there on the boat or gossiping or something. And you know, they're working pretty hard and they're volunteering to help everyone have a better race experience. So I wonder what some of your challenges are, and that could be the customer, that could be Mother Nature. I'm sure there are lots of them, but if we can go over just sort of a few of the top challenges that you face.
Well, I'd say the top challenge in the Chesapeake is typically lack of wind, or wind that won't make its mind to settle in. And that is probably the most difficult thing to deal with. And the thing that frustrates the racers too. I mean, when I'm sitting on the other side and I'm sitting there trying to keep the crew primed and ready to go for a race, it's very frustrating to go through a series of delays or whatever, especially if you think the wind is sailable. And some classes have some guidelines for you that you know, the wind has to settle down to be swinging back and forth not more than 15 or 20 degrees, and it's got to be over 5 knots and so forth. But a lot of classes don't give you any guidance at all, so it's up to you to try to get a race off. And you know, that's pretty frustrating. The one thing that I think that we try to do and have been reasonably successful at is to keep in mind that perfection is generally the enemy of good enough. And most people would like to race, even if it's not a perfect race course. So, you know, you make your best average guess of the wind direction and your best guess for a start line, and you send people off, unless it's a championship level. Championship level, a little different. There you've got some more restrictive guidelines, and you sometimes have to wait around when you'd rather be racing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, to dovetail on that, that's one of the most important things I think that we do at most of the regattas that I do, not all of them, but most of them. We sit down with the class reps or email, and we really take the time to understand what they want. To understand, as Bruce mentioned, the wind ranges and what does that mean? And is it 5 feet off the water line, or is it 40 feet off the water line? And is it in miles per hour or knots? When do you abandon? What does the class think would be the requirements to abandon? And just, you know, that list goes on and on and on because every class is different. So we spend a lot of time trying to understand what the racers want, because that's what we're out there to do. We're racers, we're running races for racers. And so I think that's the biggest challenge, because everybody gets this idea that, you know, maybe everybody's not quite on the same page about the parameters and the guidelines for racing. Some classes are super about it, and they give you on the website class guidance on running regattas, whether it's a local or a national or whatever, different levels of regattas, how does the decision tree look? And I think once you figure out that information, and it may be one thing for the top of the fleet or the bottom of the fleet. I won't mention where we were, but we were somewhere, and the bottom of the fleet was really struggling. So we had to make decisions based on the back of the fleet. Now, you don't really like to do that. You know that people in the front don't want to hear it. But anyway, sometimes at some regattas, you just have to make that decision. So my last point is that the best race managers, and I know you're on this line today, the best race managers are the ones that have been there and have had the opportunity to be stuck with a bad decision, because you come out on race committee and you won't make that decision for other people. Mm-hmm. So that's why it's great to have racers running races.
Yeah, absolutely. I was thinking that, you know, someone came up to me at a party one time, just gives you a little window into my world, saying, you need to write an article about why they never run races when it's windy in Annapolis. And apparently, you know, they decided for whatever reason one night not to race because it was too windy. And you know, so there was someone, there was bar whining happening that night. So what would be your response? Do you get that sort of thing? Just walk around being race committee? Do you have people coming up to you telling you what you do all the time? Or
actually, you just said a very important thing. Walk around. And when either of us are race committee, one of the things we always try to do is walk through the party or the festivities afterwards or whatever and talk to the racers, because we want to hear what they liked and what they didn't like, especially what they didn't like.
Yeah.
If everybody tells you you're doing a great job, that's not a lot of help. But if people complain, believe it or not, that actually can be helpful, so long as they know they have some distinct complaint. The business about wind in Annapolis, that's a tough one. And I feel for the folks that try to run weeknight races here, because you've got kind of a triple whammy going on. You've got the unpredictableness of the pop-up thunderstorms that come through and can be quite breezy. I know, not last year, I guess it was the year before, because we didn't race much in COVID, but the year before, we were doing a Wednesday night, and we got the race got abandoned partway through, but being the first class off, we were already 3 miles out or 2.5 miles out when it hit. And, you know, it was 30 or 40 knots out there and driving rain and all, and that wasn't very pleasant. But, you know, we're fine. We have an experienced crew and all of that. But there were folks out there that were really struggling. And, you know, you don't have a lot of safety boats out there and that sort of thing. So it's a tough call, especially for a Wednesday night or a Friday night or a Thursday night race committee. That is a tough one. So you tend to err on the side of being conservative if you think there's going to be a storm or there's going to be a lot of breeze. Mm-hmm. Now, championship level regatta on the weekend, you know, that sort of thing. I would let the class limits dictate whether I'd go out or not. And if the class limit's 30 knots, you go out and it's 28 knots out there, you go out in 28 knots. And sometimes that's pretty rough on the race committee, depending on how big your race committee boats are.
Yeah,
that's true. That's a good point. Sometimes it's easier on the sailors than it is on the power boats that are out there trying to lift anchors and move marks around.
Yeah. So we don't have a lot of questions coming in from the audience tonight, so I'm just going to keep going with mine. So what do you wish more sailors knew about race committee work and what you do on the boat?
Well, I'll take this one. So I'd encourage people, racers, to go out on race committee, because they're going to be better racers when they do it. They're going to understand what's going on in the race committee's mind, how they do it, the timing, what they may or may not do. And it's just been really interesting over the years to see how much you learn and how much you can see from a race committee boat that's going to be helpful for you in your racing career. So that's one thing I'd like to see. I know some clubs kind of put people in and out of race committee. It'd be good to get a position. I always like the position of the racing consultant. So this is the person that you talk to. Oh, would you go left or would you go right? And why would you go left? And that information can help us set up our start line. The racer can kind of see how we do it. So that's always a great opportunity to learn more.
Mm-hmm. I hear that time and time again from race committee members that they learn so much about racing by being on race committee. And I can tell you, even just by being in the photo boat out sometimes, somebody will go by and you're thinking, oh, no wonder you're struggling. You're all sheeted in. Or, you know, that you can just see things when you're not actively working on a boat and you're really just watching. And so to be on a boat with a bunch of people who really know racing, the stuff that you would see in the conversation there that's going on around you, I think would be just really instrumental to making you a better racer. So how do people get involved? I mean, I've had people ask me, and that I do say we have a couple questions coming in, but I do have people ask me, or they say, I'm kind of intrigued by volunteering on race committee, but I've only ever been on a boat a few times. I'm not super experienced. And I always say, oh, by all means, like, find a club and ask them if they need volunteers, because they're going to say yes. they would love a body of someone who is willing to learn. And what would be your recommendation if someone's interested in volunteering?
So if they're interested to talk to either CBYRA, run some races, or if they're a member of a sailing association or yacht club or Naval Academy Sailing Squadron or West River, whatever it may be, call the race committee chairman or email them and let them know that you would be interested. That would be one route. The other one would be to get to know, you know, maybe you know a timer who does race committee at your club. Ask them to get you connected there.
Yeah, and I would say don't be discouraged if you're told, well, we're happy to have you out, but your primary job is going to be pulling the anchor. Doesn't make any difference. You can really learn even there. And we all started, well, I won't say we all started, but I certainly started by pulling anchors. And, you know, then it got to be more than that. And of course, in the college and the small boat sailing, that's part of the routine. You got to go out. You got to go out and drop anchors and help the coach and everything get going anyhow. So everybody gets their opportunity that way. But you learn an astounding amount just by being out on the water and watching the race progress.
Mm-hmm. I see that Cheryl Cook has a question. How do race committee get involved with America's Cup level?
Hi, Cheryl. That's a good question, how you can get involved at high-level competitions. One of the ways is to figure up who's running it and send them an email and see if you can get on or if you know. And that's happened a lot at Miami or sometimes at Charleston. Sometimes they may need a skill, you know, so just ask. You might have to ask a lot. If you want to get involved with America's Cup, it might be a little bit bit of a challenge. But just keep asking and keep your skills sharp and get as much, you know, if it's something you're really interested, you know, get as much experience in what you want to do as you can. And for the America's Cup if I know race committee would be really hard to probably get on for that level. But maybe there's some other area where you could volunteer, you know, maybe shore support or some other area. That's kind of how, you know, we started being press boat drivers. And then you kind of work your way up a little bit with your connections.
Yeah, can we talk about I'm sorry. Go ahead, Bruce.
I was going to say that, you know, at the very top level, the America's Cup or the TP52 crowd or the super yacht crowd. And we have been involved a little bit, not in America's Cup, but in some of the other levels. It takes a long time. I mean, it takes 20 or 30 years of being involved with the people and actually being around with the PROs and that sort of thing. But you do start by doing things like the Miami series down in Biscayne Bay, the various world sailing and U.S. sailing sponsored series are probably the best way to get to know the right people in order to get into that more rarefied level of race committee management. Now, of course, when you get there, the risks are much higher, and I'm not sure the rewards are any better.
I have one more question before we roll into a couple of our audience questions. Let's talk a little bit about certifications. We mentioned at the very beginning that you can get some certifications through U.S. Sailing. Can you guys talk about the certifications that you have and what some of the processes are for getting certified to be on race committee?
All right. Yeah, there's a lot of different levels. You can be certified as a race officer, umpire, measurer, judge. Through U.S. Sailing, they have a lot of courses, a lot of education courses. They have a Race Committee 101, which is actually pretty good, that your yacht club can go on and you just want to be on race committee, you know, get your yacht club to run the RC 101. And then there are, if you do want to get certified, which is great, it teaches you to be a principal race officer. You can go online, just look U.S. Sailing Race Management Seminars, and all of the, we call it the basic, it's online. They're online right now. Pretty soon we're going to pivot to do both online and in-person basic race management seminars. So these are all through U.S. Sailing. And from a club race officer all the way up to an international race officer, U.S. Sailing can teach you, or actually that's my role, teach you, guide you, mentor you to how to continue to improve your skills to meet whatever certification level that you might be interested in.
Great. So we have a question from Todd Johnson here about racing. As both racers and race committee people, do you regret the almost exclusive use of windboard leeward courses?
All right, Bruce, you can do that one.
Well, I think you've seen a pivot a little bit away, at least in the Chesapeake, from the strict windward leeward courses. We've always had a few point-to-point courses and around the buoy courses in the Chesapeake. But lately, I would say in the last 5 years, you see more and more clubs offering more buoy racing courses as well as point-to-point courses. And I think that's in response to what we hear from the racers who say, you know, the drop mark windward leeward courses are great for the pros and the high level racers, but gee, I just want to take my family out and go out for an afternoon sail around the marks. And you know, the windward leeward courses don't do that because, you know, something's happening all the time and I got to have a skilled bow and I got to have this and that, and it's not much fun. So yes, I think we're going to see, I don't know that we'll see many more than we have now, but certainly we're seeing, have seen a large increase in the buoy and point-to-point racing.
I think there's one coming up next week, or maybe in August. Maybe it's the first weekend in August, the Two Bridge Fiasco.
Oh, yeah.
It really puts any kind of boat in there. You can have anything from a classic yacht like Gary Jobson's boat to a foiling board. To a 505, to a J30, J105, you know, to our boats that we have around here. So that should be a great fun race for people who are looking for something a little different. And I think it's August 2nd.
Yeah, I think you're right. If it's not the 2nd, it's the 1st. But it is that weekend. And I will say that was one of the most exciting days of the year in 2020. Now, it was COVID, and so everyone was a little stir crazy, but the energy on the water that day, I just don't remember a day that was more exciting than that. I was sort of giddy with excitement. I wasn't even racing. It was really a fantastic race. So anyone who wants to participate in that race, I encourage you to go check it out online and sign up and join the
fun. Please sign up early because sadly, unfortunately, I think I'm the one that's going to have to figure out everybody's Portsmouth handicap for starting times, and I'm going to need as much time as I can get for that. But we had literally everybody from like classic Harishoff 28 yawl to a foiling board. And
somebody had a wasp or a moth or something out there, and then everything in between.
And the ratings in a perf standpoint ranged basically from something like minus 80 to plus 312 or something like that. Yeah. So it was, you know, as wild a conglomeration as you could get.
Well, and down on the Southern Bay, I don't know if anyone has read that racing section of SpinSheet in the July issue, but they're trying something new down in the Southern Bay too, and they're calling the Triple Tunnel Terror. And it's the same concept. They just don't have as many bridges down there, but they have a lot of tunnels. So they have their own version of it happening down there. It's in the SpinSheet calendar. It's just nice to see, and thank you for your question, Todd, but it is nice to see that there's some creativity out there, and new races are happening each year, and they're pretty exciting, I think. Tom Price had a question. Your thoughts on non-binding hailing OCS competitors?
Oh, it gets back to what the class wants. So OCS is probably, Tom, as you know, one of the biggest penalties that's out there, and it's hard to recover. And as star sailors, or maybe as bull and bear boat sailors, you know, it's hard to get your boat turned around and back. With the advent of radios on some of the sailing small keel boats, you know, the question continues to be raised. But the other question is, if they don't have radios and you have a really long starting line, are you being unfair to someone? So There's a lot of pro and cons on hailing. I know generally we do hail our big boat racers, keel boats over like 24 feet are being hailed. I'm getting ready to do a small boat race, a Worlds, and they don't want to be hailed. So that decision is really made between the principal race officer and the organizing authority and your class representative and your class. And it gets back to the class with a capital C. The class really gives guidance to the organizing authority on the what kind of game they want to run. And OCS hail or no hail, or maybe hailing a Papa flag and then the other ones posting it. All that is really is driven by the class. So I get out of that one. So it gets down to fairness, whatever is the most fair start. But you know the rules. It's your responsibility to start correctly, and then it goes out from there.
Mm-hmm. So I know that you guys have traveled a lot for race committee work. Maybe you can tell us some of your very favorite venues over the years, or just regattas that, oh, that was the best because blank, or just tell us about some of your fabulous experiences off the Chesapeake.
You know, we've been everywhere, but what I will say, we've been a lot of places, but you got to stick your nose out of the Chesapeake to get a little bit better. You just have to keep challenging yourself. And that's kind of what we did as racers and as race officers. So I'll pass that along to you, but the many, you can't compare like a Screw Power Regatta, a Charleston Race Week, the former Key West Race Week, Kenwood Cup in Hawaii, all the Block Islands, you know, Class Worlds, you know, they're all great. And it takes everybody to really, really put them together from the land staff and the regatta chair. There's so many people that are important to make them happen. And we're a sport of passion. A lot of people just do what they can to make all these regattas really great. So that's a tough question, Molly.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's my job.
Well, I'll pipe in. I will tell you that I thought Kenwood Cup was really both to race it and to do race committee. That was an outstanding regatta. And I think Key West was another one, pretty spectacular. I know that a lot of people missed it when it shut down, but there were a lot of reasons, and it just it became an impractical regatta to run without heavy sponsorship. Now I know folks are trying to get it started up again, and I'm just hoping the sponsorship will be there. But trying to run a regatta in a place where you don't have an established yacht club with established race committee gets to be very, very difficult, because when you have to import everything, it gets to be quite expensive. And even if you're not, and I don't, you know, despite the question on America's Cup, except for the America's Cup, people don't get paid for race committee. So even if you're not there getting paid, somebody still has to get you housing and food and all of that stuff. And it just gets to be a huge expense. But some of those remote place regattas are really pretty fantastic.
Yeah. So what is it about? And thank you, Lee. Thank you for your comment. And it's nice to have someone from Waikiki Yacht Club tuning in to the Happy Hour. We're happy to have you back. So I always wondered, you know, back when Key West was happening, and even many times with Charleston, I've taken a look at the race committee and thought, my gosh, or I've been at a sailing conference. You know, we've done that one out in San Diego, and we've done it down in Florida before, one of the U.S. sailing forums. And I thought, wow, we really breed a lot of really exceptional race committee members on the Chesapeake Bay. We have a hub here. Is that because of you, Taryn? Is that because you're teaching all of them? Why is it?
But of course. No, but I think what it is, is that we have a lot of racing here, a lot of racing on the East Coast. And for example, let me think of a current. Mark Murphy would go out and do a sonar regatta, the Sonar Worlds, and he'd come back and we'd hear all about it, you know, over at the over dinner, over at the bar. Or Joe Krolak would go to Cowles or somewhere and he'd come back and he'd talk about it. So we've got really a hub of discussion, of knowledge. I don't run all these races, but I have the benefit of talking to the people who may be running all these races, and we hear what the challenges are, and for the most part, most people share the challenges.
Yeah. And part of the other thing is, if we are so lucky as to have been invited to be a race officer or a high-level person associated with one of these away regattas, and they're short of people, we tend to try to pull the people we know from the Chesapeake, because if especially if you're in a place where it's not your home port, you like to have as high a comfort level as you can get in terms of timing and flags and all the mechanics of the race committee. So you will tend to bring along the people you can if you have the opportunity. Mm-hmm. So we have developed a lot of folks that way, I think.
All right, we're getting on last call here, but we do have one question. It's kind of a long question, Sharp. Do you think we can fit that on the... We can fit it. So Bill Barrera, thank you so much for the question. I'm a new racer. My best finish has been second to last. I hate giving up and calling it quits when I'm way far behind, but I don't want to keep the race committee waiting on me, especially on longer distance races, say 20 miles. At what point do you think I should call the race committee and say, go ahead and leave, I'll call you when I cross the line? It's a good question. We've all been there.
Well, if it's me, you shouldn't call, because I think the race committee owes it to the racers to be there. And I will stick it out to till the last person crosses the line, because they've put forth all of the effort to get out there and race and do that sort of thing. The only time that I actually have gone and shortened races or given people a finish in place is on a multiple race day where I need to run a second race and I need to get everybody back to the start line so I can run the second or the third race of the day.
Mm-hmm. So I just have a quick comment on there. Maybe when you do get in, try to run into your friends who maybe were in front of you or in your class and see if you can get some advice. Ask them, you know, do I need to clean my bottom, or do I need, you know, do I need to trim my head sail differently, or whatever it is. Just see if you can get some advice. And most sailors will be glad to sit down and talk to you about their little go fast secrets.
I know some people who might think you need new sails.
Well, that new sails never hurt, but you know, it's really funny. Kind of on a whim, the blockade runner crew jumped into Cal 25s for the second half of Frostbite. In the first year, we went out with not much in the way of new sails, you know, we weren't last, but we certainly weren't first. And we've been improving the sails and the bottom both as we've been going along, although we're still not quite to the far 30 level yet. But we've been getting better. But I will say that you know, there's nothing wrong with asking your competitor for a little advice, because they're probably going to be more than happy to give it to you. And it will be good advice, and you'll go faster.
Yeah, and as an armchair spectator, you know, sometimes I'm the Monday morning spectator looking at the results online, and it's fun to watch people start in they're in last place all year, and then the next year they move up a couple notches, and then the next year they move up a couple notches, and then, you know, sometimes they find themselves at the top of the podium and they stay out there because they keep at it. And it's always a joy for me to run into people and meet them and say, good for you, you kept at it year after year. You know, they had the passion and they worked at it. So, well, Taryn and Bruce, we have hit last call. If you have any final comments you'd like to make about race committees and how we can help you do your jobs better, we welcome that.
Well, we really appreciate being here tonight. If you have any questions, give us a call. You know, I think a lot of race managers are pretty open. Stop us on the docks, give us your opinion. Let us know how we can do better at our sport.
Great.
Yeah. It's always, we always try to do the best job we can, and you know, we're always open to advice and comments, and we might not take it, but we'll certainly listen.
Yeah.
And it's, we all can get better.
Well, thank you guys for being with us. It's really been a pleasure. And thank you to everyone in our audience who has stayed on the show tonight and ask questions, and make sure to wave and say thank you to the race committee the next time you see them, or to stop by and chat with them at the party and ask them about how it went. And Sharb is probably going to kick us into the green room. So Bruce and Taryn, I hope you'll stick around. We're going to have a little party after party in the green room like usual. And also let our audience know that next Monday we are going to have another happy hour. And we're going to be talking about the fabulous races you should do in winter 2022. It's time to sign up for your winter races. So we're going to talk about that.
Very cool. Well, thank you guys. I'm going to put you into the green room, but stick around.
Have a great week, everybody.
And I want to thank everybody for joining in. This actually was a great show. I appreciate you tuning in on a Monday. It's not exactly when think of happy hour, but you should be out on the water sailing on Friday night. So we'll continue doing our Monday happy hours. And next week, this would be a really good one. We've got some great folks on sharing about some of the regattas that you know and love that exist during the cold times, but some new ones coming up too. So please tune in for that. If you enjoyed the program, please tell your friends about it too. Share it everywhere you can. And until next time, thank you very much. Thank you to Mount Gay for sponsoring this episode. And we'll see you next week. Take care, everybody.